Nhưng quý hiệu Mai Vang, quý hiệu founder the Hmong Museum, ý lưu ý khó chơi khờ Hmong giáo thanh tử. Bế khó program Hmong Chronicles, yếu bế khó chú ý, bế tờ lưu, bế hát tà, bế sáng lưu cầu, dù bế Hmong giáo folk tales, bế Hmong giáo stories, tên tử, tế xí mà bế chú bó yếu cầu lấy chăng. Yếu lưu bế hát tà, bế yếu cho cháu lao lưu chú, ôn chú cháu lùa, ế cháu lùa cầu tàu ý chăng. Story in the jolao je bo chale lu ka ta o la perform ta I kho jo be tan cho sai mono be jeng ka ka le ya ni yo I tu e shao da ni pon da who are the song poet han tu shao I pa on dei who are the late homecomer and ni ta award cho ni jo upon da na no je ni pon da the song poet yo zu nu ji bi ya program đào hình giang tận đây nó cho họ đặc biệt sang khờ mong cho thành tựu ha tận đây nó chỉ trong sau để bây giờ sang tàu ít lúc chế mong museum để bây khởi tàu bây giờ không giờ đặc biệt sang báo chữ rồi mấy sang báo chí để mấy email chữ cũ về cũ chả được khởi tàu cho mấy bây giờ mỗi khờ Facebook ha giờ đặc biệt chả mong museum cũ khờ Facebook để mấy chả tàu bây ha mấy bộ giờ không bây qua
cú gió tua hay ít ra cứ xe kia cho mình nhổ mông hạt tiền giả nói cho mông ít chữ chờ bộ thổ u làm mù ấy nên tua nhau tới chuyện nói chuyện trả tới cứ xe lù tàu nó được lo là chuyện mà nó cú gió mua ô số lù tàu hay rồi nên sẽ đầm nông hạt tiền lù tàu hay đi già lù nua mà hạt tiền hay cứ xe lù số hay đi già ấy cái này cho mình nhổ này bảo thì họ nói giờ bên địa tuần rồi bên cho mông tan họ sẽ đỡ ai cũng vẫn sẽ được cho họ nên sẽ được chứng do các cho họ để dù hay năng để cứ chuyện này để giả cố cố ở dù hay năng ít chữ mua nó nữa anh nên sẽ được chứng tuân lòng nữa.
I want to thank all of you for being here. I'm actually a court qualified interpreter people, so this is legit. Okay. I want to thank all of you for being here tonight, especially the young ones. I want you to hear that this is a song from our people. Documents part of our history and our lives and our tears and our experiences. And so I want your ears and your hearts to hold what you hear tonight. I'm going to take a seat, but I'll come back and transliterate the song for you. Dad's going to sing it. He has a bit of a cold, so if he coughs, please forgive him.
我一望过那天都裂了我能装的得借我了有着路窄路土我着路地母我着么哦哦你老老当过我母爹路着路窄路土得路地不爱 哦你到了王国路王道出来王国里几道王国拉几道都里乱拆王国拉有没有都里要一时能不知不断王国拉哦铁里到他都里我一一能老实说了哦路得路就几种啊 Oni tau chi te cho chơi chơi ni tua la lo chua zeng trung yi zeng chua Oni tua la lo chua ra mong yi ra shua mo Oni tua zang duan zeng tu te cho na ni mo tu mo ki le mo nyua จิตโตลูใจลูใจลูยงอยัวมูนทอลัวเกินโตมูลอเกินเตอตุกิกว่าจีกันแอมยัวหนอยัวหอแอเทียลีโตจัวร้อนตือมูนทอลัวคือแอมอันนี้คืออีสีนังเราลีนอลอฮอนี่เจ้าลุนตูหลงหัวเตหลงจัว蒙古里街，你有我毛龙祖街，这里个路途车，这里个不走，路途宽了，蒙古里也生了里，养得还不多，蒙古来都写的新潮，我呢生了里养，得了我一肉能做点，得有了点了个一肉。 地爱老我了个一肉包了好家哈路能爱老可以是能老里闹了路能正月走几脚路么？哦，哦你姐蒙古里天蒙古拉天都里爱你老老老我能爱，能年能几月有老着路家哦路都我着路地。 木我找哎，哦你爹你老老当个，这头路窄哦，路途坡木路得得哎，蒙古里天都拉，这都拉都里，直到蒙古拉拢，这哦都里远叫蒙古拉一时能去报告哎，田里到我一人木西个哎。 哦，你听你家路途坡，马路对桥，哎，多几对脚车车拉拉脚路中一路的，哦，你多头里个不转正途，一正桥么？哦，你多转多正途对桥那。 哦，蒙古拉铁都理解，摩都摩基勒得西德，知道路窄啊，路窄路远啊，越木道路更多，木路更多啊，都理解蒙古拉路能解，没有路啊，走都紧走，难做上都木道路去了。 可以是能老里那年间都龙华的龙卷，哦，蒙古拉铁都理解，你我马路人住在这里，各路都车，这里个不着路都车，这都理解，你还都晓得新车着蒙古拉铁，你老见了个。 一路走，哎，老我个一路走，老家路能去老里那，哦，你知道这里高铁古路线车么？哦，哦，蒙古拉街，你生了个印度些的新朝海的，亚努拉吉乌吉莫拉。 家有都养狗，有都养鸡，路养狗，种哎，有养鸡，有同多些木工多好不？哎，家有木，二零幺哎，多二零木，哎，都里点都你莫个来，做给老我能种点地哎，哎，家有搞点木工，多古木老古多哎。 一弄都拿得不正，耳朵毛，俺才搞有木头了，搞铁骨有木头了，骨头毛，好些小搞不好要天，小骨老不要着，老我能给蒙古拉都些的，心头的姐姐让二老带。 哦，年节又要走路，养个肉哎，二年同多把，二年同多，不然木工多些，节节二木二零幺，多二二零木哎，多里点木过来，年老我能种点地呢，年节二同多些木工，多不。 lo u chi to thong pa thong to cho cong to mo u ne thong to ple mu cong to xie lo u chi u ne chi thong to pa mu cong to xie inu dun da tu chi tia ra u lo ta plo chen u to mo em che yo có yo mu thờ lỡ có chớ cú yo mu thờ lỡ cú thiê có quan yo trơ chê cú yo chỉ yo thiê ở mò ở đu ni mong go la thiê tu li lu nang chê tu xiê tê xin thoi mong go tu li hai sinh lỡ yu yên châu ở mong go la thiê đu ni mi mong go la ê yo ni lo wo nang châu luôn thiê tê nói ông nè từ yêu chơi yêu từ lo chơi yêu từ tuổi ông nương nhau in nu đủ ra tuổi ở trên ta ru tua mua ở mu thờ ông nương lo cho cò yêu mu chia tòa họ chùa chỗ gì cha nương lỡ lần tương sai cho cũ họ yêu mu chia tòa chùa chỗ gì cha nương lỡ lần ly tư vô ư tua ư mua mua nhu mua nang lo che yo trâu lo che mua nhu lo yo trâu lo tàu che ư mua miền đông mẹ che miền đông sĩ ya đó rung lo là tung mua in châu ê ở chùa mò lư cơ tua lo chia rung lơ la tung a trung cò thia cú ư a chi pu lơ nia lo ư vô a chia ư mà lam lùng tua si hi tung lan si lơ tê xin po a chan tu lơ li ti a ư mà tơ pa lơ li răng trô lơ nia ta mê mu ho a lo na chê ư ua mê lùng tu lơ yu yang a trô lợ nè nà mê nông mù tò lù chân gấu à mò ê ư lù mê nâng ô dì lù ngờ rong ê nè thịa lì nhò y xì nâng ê nè thịa y thịa à mù chì bò sò mò tù lì hai sân lợ yù yàng trô muang gò la thịa ô lợ nâng nhò ê dà dà yù chè yù dà lò chè yù dà lò ê y nù tù nà tư ê ư bò chân ri tua mù ê chè ư chì tò mù ô nâng ê xò gò yô mù chè tò chùa chò yì gù yô mù chè tò chùa chò yì chà nâng ê lợ lăng li tư bò ê họ có họ yếu mu chia to chùa chỗ gì cha nâng lỡ lăng li tương sai ư mu o nhu lo trâu luôn đầu o nâng trâu lo chè chia ư mu o miền đông miền chia đông sĩ chia ở ni yếu mu thọ rung lỡ là tầng o yên sai o mò mi chùa mò lư cơ ôm lỡ tua lo chia rung lỡ là tầng e trung cò thia cú ư e chi pu lỡ nè lo ư tai e ư e mi mu lam lòng tua si tầng lan si lỡ tề sim po e nè chia chan tu chê chia ư tơ pa lỡ li răng e trâu nè ta mi mu tai lo na chia chia ư mu ôm bên lòng tu lỡ yu yang e trâu lợn nè nam miền nông ai thiệt tàu lợn nè lũ chân trái ở mò ai ô nương nhỏ ô chỉ lũ gấu rong ai ư lũ nương chế thiệt lũ nhỏ ý sĩ nương nè thiệt ý chỉ thiệt chỉ tàu sinh trái ở mò mong gấu li ai ô ông đồ ni chế yo chế sĩ vợ yo sĩ chủ li chủ ai chủ lũ mù cứ câu chua ủa lợn nằng nhỏ à, do gì luôn gỡ chua, chế ý gì nằng ê, do bò chân mua, chế lợ chủ chưa ư cái gì luôn gỡ chua, ý gì nằng trả xa nhưng lự tiề ư chỉ si chua. Ủa nên sẽ được chọn đâu nè?
Thank you, Daddy. Không muốn vào tao thì không muốn vào cái gì mà đã lo. People have asked me what my great literary influences were, and I've often said Louise Erdrich because I love her. I've talked about Robert Frost. I've rarely talked about Bia. For most of my life, I've described my dad as a machinist, and that is a song poet that I know him to be. Tonight is the first time that I get to do my art alongside my dad's. I cannot do justice to the beauty of my father's language, but this is my best effort at communicating his song. So the song is for my mom. It's titled Single Shihu, Marital Love. In the song, my father has named them Muangola. Is her name, and Du Li is his name. Both names are references to when they were born, the 1950s, the height of America's secret war in Laos. Both my mother and my father were born too late in the life of their parents and their country to know the beauty of peace. Verse 1. Oh, my Hmong sisters, all Hmong people, let us talk about the story of two individuals, Muangola and Du Li, and the lives that they were born into. Their parents gave birth to Muangola and Du Li at a time of great strife. The sky was abuzz with the sting of bees, and the land was full of the tiger's roar. Muangola and Du Li became a young man and woman beneath a sky that was broken open, on land that had torn apart. If Muangola had not made the decision to be with Du Li, then she would have spent her whole life missing him until she grew old and died. Thus, Muangola made the decision to be with Du Li, to walk toward marriage. Alas, there was no peace in the country they called home. And Muangola and Du Li were forced to flee, washed upon the tides of war, from one country into another. They crossed over 9 hills and 8 mountains. They crossed over 9 Hmong villages and 8 foreign towns. Oh, my Hmong people. Muangola made it to this new country and left her mother and her father as places of love, sisters-in-laws and brothers as sites of missing. When she arrived, Muangola had sons and daughters and did not have the time to go with others to learn of different cloths and new letters. In the new language, Muangola did not have enough words. Oh, my Hmong people. Muangola washed her strength into the currents of poverty, toiling into old age. The sky changed its clouds and the land shifted the winds. Muangola grew weak with aches and the pains as the seasons changed. Oh, my Hmong people. Muangola laments to Du Li. Du Li, we have been given lives and I have lived as your wife. We've toiled to old age. But why is it that our lives cannot keep pace with others? Verse 2. Oh, my Hmong sisters, all Hmong people, Muangola and Du Li were born into a country rifled with war. Muangola and Du Li grew up and became young men and women at a time when the sky was broken open and the land torn apart. Oh, Hmong, my Hmong people. If Du Li had not made the decision to be with Muangola, then he would have spent his whole life missing her endlessly. Thus, Du Li made the decision to be with Muangola, to walk toward marriage. Alas, there was no peace in the country they called home, and Du Li and Muangola were forced to flee, washed upon the tides of war from one country into the other. They crossed over 9 hills and 8 valleys. They crossed over 9 folds of sky and 8 folds of earth. They traveled far across the distance to this country, and they had to forsake brothers and sisters as places of love, neighbors and friends as wishes and desires. Oh, my Hmong people. From the moment they arrived, Muangola and Du Li had sons and daughters, and Du Li did not have the time to go with others to learn of different cloths and letters. In the new language, Du Li did not have enough words. Du Li washed her strength into the currents of poverty, toiling into old age. The sky changed its clouds, and the land shifted the winds. Du Li grew weak with aches and pains as the seasons changed. Oh, my Hmong people. Du Li laments to Muangola, Muangola, we have built a life and I have lived as your husband. We've toiled and toiled into old age, but why can't we reach our aspirations? Oh, my Hmong people. Verse 3. Muangola says sadly to Du Li, Du Li, you and I started to love when we were young. We have been able to share our hearts. Let us survive together, and when it is time for us to go, let us leave together. Thuli responds to Mongola. Mongola, we are a pair of lovers, and although we have been able to share our hearts, we only live for a time. Come here on earth under different decrees. Under some yellow sky, there will be a day when you will disappear and I will die. You will be reincarnated and I will pass to a new place. When you are gone, I don't know. I don't know if you will remember to search or if I will remember to follow. Mongola says with her broken heart to Thuli, Thuli, we are first loves and will be last. We have shared our hearts. If we live, then let us live on together. And if we die, then let us die together. Thuli responds to Mongola with the same break in his heart. Mongola, we have shared one life, but we have lived in two bodies just by the sharing of our hearts. One day when the time comes and we've gone, you will walk toward your place in the heavens and I will be reincarnated. And perhaps you will remember to follow and I will forget to search. Thuli says to Mongola, Mongola, the garments of our youth are long gone, and one day when they dissipate from our bodies entirely, let us not reincarnate as humans again, because you will become 98 possibilities of a daughter, and I will become 98 possibilities of a son. If we become cows, we may get beaten. If we become horses, we will get ridden. Let us become the straight trees in the heart of the heavy jungle and live together in a big grove. Let the harsh winds blow, let the big trees help us stand tall, shelter you and me from a fall. We will grow leaves and they will reach for each other. We will rise and grow, and in the sun we will blossom flowers with sweet nectar for the birds and the bees to drink. In the rain we will unravel our leaves, straight and long, and shelter the squirrels and the little birds from the cold. In our lifetime we have loved well and deep. Let our love stand tall as we are. Let us love into time. Let us love with no end. Thuli laments to Mongola. Mongola, one day when the garments of our lives have faded away, let us not become humans because I don't know where I will go. 98 varieties to choose from, someone else's son-in-law, and you will be 98 varieties of someone else's daughter. If we become cows, we may get beaten. If we become horses, we will get ridden. Let us become the straight trees in the heart of the heavy jungle, live together in a big grove. When the harsh wind blows, let the big trees help us stand tall, shelter you and me from a fall. Keep us from dividing at all. We will shoot roots into the ground and leaves into the air and meet. We will rise and grow, and in the sun we will blossom flowers with sweet nectar so that the birds and the bees can take their fill. In the rain we will unravel our leaves straight and long and shelter the squirrels and the little birds and grant them space to huddle close. In our lifetime we have loved well and deep. Let our love flourish far beyond us. Let us love into time. Let us love with no end and no goodbyes. Oh, my Hmong people, a love with no goodbyes. When the garments of youth are gone and the skin of life is thin, for an old love to grow young, we yearn, we yearn. That is my father's composition. It is for my mother. He has never written the words down, so he carries it in his heart. I believe this is the first time my mom has heard it live. I'm going to read a little bit from my book, The Song Poet. I'm not going to tackle Love Song Daddy. But I'm going to read a part from the very beginning of the book, the album notes, because it's very much written as a second album. In 1982, my father came out with a song album, a poetry album in the Hmong tradition. He made $5,000. That's a bestseller in the community. The goal was that he would come out with a second album. But I knew that they had the money. I was a kid. And so that fall, I went to my dad and I told him that my book bag would no longer do. I needed a new one. I was tired of sharpening the old color pencils and the pencils. And I wouldn't take them back with me to go to school. I was too embarrassed. And my dad looked at me, and then he went to the $5,000. And Doe saw, and so she said she needed a new jacket and new boots. So my dad went back to the $5,000. Then the younger kids were born, and they too needed and wanted things. And my father went to the $5,000, and the second album never came out. Transferred to the chicken drumsticks in our hands and the rice in our bowls. and we never thanked him. Like all children who are well loved, we took it as a matter of life, as a matter of course. But many years later, when my grandma died in 2003, my dad stopped singing entirely. He said he could no longer remember his songs. They had leaked out because his heart was broken. And that's when I started missing the voice I'd always heard. That song, that's the backdrop of my youth. And so I started missing it. There was a new silence in our house, and I began writing this book. I grew up surrounded by my father's words. They're familiar to me as the wind outside the thin walls of our old house across the different seasons. In the cool of autumn, the wind carries the dry, crackling leaves along the sides of York Avenue. Empty cans roll along the broken cement walk, and abandoned plastic bags fly with their ghostly goods. An occasional voice is carried in the wind, a brother looking for a sister as night falls, a baby crying for its mother, the bark of a hungry dog. In the cold of winter, the wind blows the snow off the ground and waves of white come sweeping across our tiny stretch of lawn and hit the house in sprinklings of icy snow. Invisible streams of air seep through the cracks of the old windows. And the smell of our rice-scented home swims in the currents of cold. Outside, the sound of police sirens resonates in the rippling, urgent winter winds. In the warmth of spring, the wind transforms the empty parking lot by the corner, laundromat, into a field of fallen petals as crabapple trees release their blooms, and the hard pavement feels the soft brush of tender, ephemeral beauty. Wet rain falls into shattered concrete, and the pools of black water lie still for the pink and the white and the red petals to swim in. The wind carries the voices of laughing children into our house as we watch the petals sway to and fro in the dark puddles across our street. In the heat of summer, the green grass grows while the yellow dandelions die. And in the wake of their demise, the wind carries their spirits and their seeds across open lots, rotting houses, small yards, littered avenues. And everywhere there are little parachutes of pollen floating away. Late into the night, we listen to the voices of friends and neighbors talking outside on their porches. Hear the clinking of cans, turn our heads toward their laughter and their tears, and the wind loses its appeal for a season because the pull of people grows strong across the fertile green. My father was a young man who carried on his broad shoulders 100-pound sacks of rice, while I ran as fast as I could to open the front door lest he beat me there. Then came the season when there was no danger that my father would get there before me. When I stood with the door wide open, my fingers soft against the hard wood, I watched my father age with each sack of rice we bought and ate. My weight at the front door of our house grew long as my father's steps grew heavier on the ground and his shoulders shook beneath the burden of feeding us. I'm going to read from the back of the book. I'll pick that up later. For most of our life in America, my father has worked in the factories. He's been an assembler and then a machinist. This is the work that has fed us. I'm not ashamed of it. I'm very proud of the work that his hands have done, despite the cause, the hurt that it's put into his heart. I'm going to read a little bit from the back of the book and that part of his life. At work, our supervisor was having me and 14 of my fellow Hmong co-workers run more and more machines, preparing canning and drilling tools for the big oil digging operations on the evening shift. He said that things were picking up, and if we wanted to keep our jobs, we had to work harder, faster, smarter. There was no intelligence in running the heavy machines, just alertness, all the time, energy. There was no intelligence in running the heavy machines, just alertness all the time, energy, even when our eyes grew tired and our hands started shaking. We couldn't ease up on the work, stretch our sore muscles, or close our dry eyes. I felt tremendous pressure because I could no longer hear out of my left ear, and with all the noise from the machines, my right ear wasn't holding up well. Still, my friends and I persisted. We were men without options. Many of us had worked over a decade at the company. We knew we would not be able to find other work. We didn't have other skills. More critically, we were all too old to start anew elsewhere. One of our oldest co-workers, Nia, had developed carpal tunnel. The muscles in his hands had grown weak. He was being asked to run 4 machines. I couldn't help him because I was the last guy on the line, the polisher. Every piece of tool had to pass by me. But one of the younger guys who could speak English asked our supervisor if he could help Nia by running 1 more machine so that Nia could run 1 less. The supervisor said, "Fuck you," and walked away. During the break, the men and I talked about what was happening in the company. We knew that this time the pressure was on Nia, but it could be on any one of us. I myself had carpal tunnel in both hands and had undergone surgery to keep the pain under control. But of course, I did the same work, so the same symptoms were coming back. At night, I could no longer pull the covers over me. Sometimes my hands caused me so much pain that it woke me from sleep. I didn't say any of this to the men. All I said was, "We are friends. We have to love each other. If we don't, there's no one here to love us." We did not expect to be treated like the white men we worked with. None of us got opportunities to train on the fancier machines. Many of us were in positions where the pay was capped. When production slowed, we were often the first to be sent home without pay. At a company barbecue to reward us for our hard work and excellent production, we, not the other people, were asked to eat the hot dogs that fell on the ground. We wanted to have a conversation with management about the real danger we were in, running so many machines at once, not about the way management treated us in comparison to our white coworkers. At the end of the break, we agreed to let the younger men who could speak English talk to the supervisor and request a team meeting. We knew we needed to talk. We would be stupid if we didn't speak up and something dangerous happened to any one of us. At the end of the shift, as we were clocking out, the younger men told each of us that the supervisor said we could talk tomorrow as a group. I drove home that night underneath a waning moon. I needed gas, but I didn't stop at a gas station. The price per gallon was $3.42. I had no money in my wallet. I knew I should not use the bank card. The house was quiet. Everyone had gone to bed already. It was past midnight. Ju had left a small bowl of rice and a plate of blanched mustard greens on the table for me. Although I was hungry, I didn't feel like eating. I showered. I tried to sleep. Ju slept on her side, on the shoulder that didn't hurt, turned away from me. My hands hurt. I got up and I left the bedroom. In the kitchen, there were a few spotted bananas. I had one. I walked to the living room. I turned on the television. It was a news channel. Syria was going further into civil war. The U.S. military death toll in Afghanistan had reached 2,000. I sat in front of the television until my eyes closed. Ju woke me up sometime before dawn when she realized I was not beside her. I was tired the next day, but it was nothing different from so many other days. I got ready for work, putting on my uniform and my safety-toe boots. I said goodbye to my children. Ju wanted to know why I was going to work early. I told her about the conversation with the supervisor. Ju approved. She hated that I didn't speak up for myself at work. Ju felt bad about not working. She worried about me. Ju knew about the carbide particles in the air and the dangers of operating heavy machinery and working with hard metals. Like me, she had come to accept it. Still, running multiple machines felt illegal to her. She urged me to speak up even if I had to use one of my friends as an interpreter. I told her I would if it became necessary. She said that she would be by the phone, waiting for me to call at break time. Most of the men had arrived early. We asked the young ones to check with the supervisor to see when the conversation would be. We were tense, but calm. We were quiet as we waited. We all looked tired beneath the bright factory lights. When the two young men came back shaking their heads at each other, we knew something was wrong. When we could see the supervisor walking behind them, we didn't know what to expect. The supervisor did not wear a uniform like us. He did not have on the blue polyester shirt with his name and position on it, and the blue worker pants. A tall man, he towered behind the two Hmong men walking quickly toward us. There was no time for them to interpret. There was no need. The supervisor said, "Guys, if you don't like the way things are operating, leave." We understood his words. The young men who could speak English tried to explain to him that we were not giving up our jobs. They said that we only wanted to talk. The supervisor shook his head. He would not talk with us. There would be no conversation. He ordered each man to his station. My feet would not move. I thought about Jew not having a job. I thought about my younger children at home who needed more time to go to school. Zhu, Lu, Shell, Tay, and Max. I thought about Dao just having had a baby and Kalia still struggling to build her career. I thought about Zhu waiting for me by the phone. I thought about my mother dying. I thought about my older brothers who never had a chance to work in America. I thought about Hu with his own business in America. I thought about the things I had spent most of my life thinking about: fate, destiny, life, and death. I did not heed the orders to go to my station. I found the heart of me that was Su, my rebellious son, my unhappy child in America. My struggling child who knew he did not fit in and did not try to. All of us stayed in place. We said, we're going to get our tools from the lockers. We're going home. We will return when the company is willing to talk with us. We had lived in America for a long time. We had seen the movies and heard the news about the workers like us, Mexican workers and Chinese workers, African American workers and women and children, making a stand until the conversations were had. While many of us did not speak English fluently because at work we were not expected to talk to each other, only to the machines, we understood enough. Perhaps hoping that the supervisor would have the conversation with us, we gave him another opportunity to pay a little respect from one human being to another. We repeated what we had said. We're leaving if we cannot talk to management about what is going on here. The supervisor had never seen us stand up for ourselves. He had yelled at us throughout the years. He had gone angry, slammed tables, and said, "Fuck you." He looked at us, his face registering his surprise. We waited for him to find suitable words and actions. The brown clock on the white wall ticked away the minutes. The supervisor's bafflement turned to anger as his face grew red. He said, "Before you walk out of here, think about your children." He did not understand us at all. He did not know why men like us stayed at places like this. He did not know the way the human heart worked, at least not ours. He didn't know that we had been thinking of our children all this time. We had not run through wars, waited in captivity, only to come to this country to work in such factories and have men like him yell at us and mistreat us year in and year out because we had not been thinking of our children. We had taught them we could survive. We had taught them how to work hard. We thought we were teaching them the important lessons. Had we forgotten in our exhaustion to teach them what we were worth, what they were worth? We would bow no longer, bend our heads no more. We were thinking about our children. We were thinking about how we, their fathers and their brothers, had to teach them that they were worth fighting for. Thank you. And I'm going to play interpreter if you have questions for my dad. And if you have questions for me, I'll try to speak slower because that's what my mom wants me to do. But please, don't be shy. Make this worth coming out on a cold night for. Let's make this unforgettable. Yes, Heidi. I'll tell my aunt and then I'll have my dad come in. My husband Aaron and I saw that there was a grant that the state of Minnesota had an arts board grant for folk and traditional art. And so I asked my dad one day, because he didn't have a job to go to anymore, I said, "Daddy, if we write this grant and if you get it, will you sing your songs?" And he and my mom were completely broke. And so he said, he looked at my mom and she looked at him and he said, "Yes." And so we wrote this grant not knowing what would happen at all, but my father got it. He got the Minnesota State Arts Board grant to come up with a second album. And so he completed it, and I was on a race with him. I wanted to finish the book before he would finish the grant. and so I did barely. But that's my side of the story. I'm now going to ask my dad and have him talk about how it was that he came to sing again. So my dad said yes, I was not working, and then Kalia approached me with the idea, but I found the songs, I found the power to come back because I thought about all of the young Hmong children. If they didn't like it and they weren't interested, that was fine. But for those who were interested, for those who would listen, I wanted to leave something behind. Because I know that what I do, song poetry, it is in danger of disappearing. Yes? That's a wonderful question. There are quite a few Hmong young people in the room. How many of you are learning how to haiku tia? Anybody? One right here, a young one. For myself, I love the poetry and the depth of the language, but I don't have the voice. My sisters say that even when I don't cry, my voice cries anyway, and nobody really wants to hear me sing for 15 minutes. They could just go and listen to a cuter one-year-old version. That's what they say. And so I'm a bit self-conscious about my voice. Because it is not only the gift of poetry that you have. You have to have a voice that's strong enough and beautiful enough to carry it. Because it is your only instrumentation, your voice. And so I personally have not been born with a voice. My dad says the task of teaching his children is very hard. He's taught us Hmong, and that was a hard task. His grandchildren, the oldest one is 7. My brother Max is more interested in the rest of than the rest of us. He's 13. This New Year's, he asked my dad to teach him how to do the spirit calling ceremony. He told me that he was interested because every year my father calls in all of our spirits, but nobody calls in his. Since my grandma's died, nobody has called in my father's spirits, and Max wanted to learn. So he's 13. Do and I, my older sister and I, we've decided that one of these days we're going to really hunker down and learn. We can beat Max at this as well. We're all a little bit competitive. Yes, Paul?
How is it that you came to know that you were a song poet?
See, Vili, ya kaha po hai, de ka yi tu nang yu zha hai ku chi ya. Tau ka chung mei mei.
Tau ku chung mei mei ma ku yin nye, ya ku yin mu gần, ya nung tu zha thia.
When I was a little boy, I loved song poetry, and so I became a student to every person who I could find who could sing song poetry well. So I learned the craft. My father likens Gutsia to country songs because it's storytelling, of course, but also you have to have a beautiful voice that others will enjoy and actively engage with. And so when he started singing, my dad had such a voice. When I was a kid, I hated it because we lived in Bamina refugee camp, and there were times that he'd be asked to publicly perform. And because my dad was young and he was good looking, all these women would be around him. And so I hated it. it's taken me a long time to get comfortable with my dad's public performance piece. Chị coi đẹp thật của chồng mẹ anh cái cứ chia chị bao nhiêu năm đâu mong thấy của chị nhẹ kia.
So far, I've known most of your names, the questions. So those of you who I don't know, yes. Oh, Daddy, wait, I'll interpret. Uncle, thank you for coming and telling us your story and you're sharing your songs. There are many types of gutia. Which is your favorite? There are two ways of doing traditional Hmong song poetry. The tonally it's slightly different. Or what I perform for you all, when there is more time, I will sing for you in the gutia voice, and you'll hear the slight difference in the way I carry my words into the world. But there's only two primary types. Right here, yes. I'll let Dad go first. See, go from Luraji, go Luraji, Jong, go Hai, La Lukiana, to Yamin, Mong, you, Mikate, La Homikate.
Jope, a big Yamin, Mong, Mangu Sahadone, ya got native to a tuna, your talk, you, your Lu Mong, to how you ying your Honang, the
Nang, for Mong youth, Mong children. I really beseech you to hold on to the language. I see it as a form of self respect. When people ask you who are you and you still want to say I'm Hmong, it is the words that you express to the world. It is that vehicle that holds the Hmong culture intact. And so I really urge all of you to hold on to your language and learn how to speak it and speak it well. Now I'm gonna play a bit of a devil's advocate. I agree with my dad that the Hmong language is supremely very, very important. But I visit schools all the time, and I meet so many young Hmong people who are unsure of themselves in Hmong because they're unsure of themselves in the language. And so they're kind of lost. And I don't want the language to be the barrier to the confidence that they can own in being Hmong. One of my sisters, Shell, reminded me that it doesn't matter who Hmong is. You could be born in China and be Hmong Chinese. You could be born in Thailand, be Hmong Thai. You could be born Hmong Lao like my parents, or Hmong American. That there is Hmong all over the world. And that in each of these places, the Hmong have become. And nobody used to say who is more or less Hmong. So I see that the language is incredibly important. Hmong is the number one language in my heart, but I speak English to work in the world that we live in, to build understanding across cultures and across far distances. Because there are many people who read my books who will never meet me. They will never hear the way I sound in Hmong. And so I don't think it's a necessary part of being Hmong, but I think it's incredibly beautiful and it's a gift that we can give each other. My children love it when I speak Hmong. They're only 17 months old and they're three. It puts them to sleep. They love it when I speak Hmong. English is harder. It's harsher. You have to wrap the air in your lung around units of meaning to make sense to a bigger world. I'm always breathless in English. In this way, I'm always weaker in English. Yes?
Yeah. I remember it still the next day. It's part of my creation. So
It's a wonderful question. Si yin ni te jang ye li pon da ye ku pli ko na pa ya. E vi le ku ye ku ye ta ta ye sho ma ma sho lo ye te mu ilu shi ho ke ku no ko ma li sho na. Ye ku tai lu ki. Ne nu te pon da da vi te jang ye li ku pli ko na pa ya. To te to ku te ti shi ha te ku ye sho. I had a conversation with my dad when he I asked him, how does a song poet become? It's just a beautiful day outside, and my dad looked sad. He looked sad a lot after the company let them go. So he was just looking outside like he did every single day and just listening to the ticking of the clock. And I said, Daddy, how did you become a song poet? I was expecting a story, but my dad just looked at me and he said, when I was a boy, my dad died when I was just 2 years old. There were very few people to say beautiful things to me. My grandma took to the mountainsides to feed, your grandma took to the mountainsides to feed us. I used to go from the house of one neighbor to the next, collecting the beautiful things that people had to say to each other. I used to whisper the words to myself. One day they escaped on a sigh and a song was born. And I thought, that's beautiful. And so I said jokingly to my dad, I said, Daddy, maybe that's the beginning of my first book. And he said, maybe it's the ending. And then he laughed and he said, nobody wants to read a book about men like me when you create books about men like Barack Obama written by themselves. My daddy loves Barack Obama. But my father has always said that I am like the dog after the scent of a bone. I don't let go. And so I wanted to prove him wrong. Because I'd seen men like my dad in New York City when he sent me to Columbia, when he didn't have the money to go there with me, and I missed him. I walked on the streets and I looked for men like him, and I saw them everywhere working in the basement restaurants, in the basements of restaurants, doing dishes and cleaning vegetables. And they came out of there at the day's end. So I knew that the book was bigger than my dad in some sense, that there were so many daughters like me and we all belonged to men like him. And I wanted to do that work. And then we were in the midst of the Great Depression, the American Depression. And I wanted to record that. I wanted to make it real, make it alive. And so I started talking about it. But I was doing so much public speaking that I couldn't write. Some people, they write so they can speak. Others speak so that they can write. I just have no words if I'm speaking. Then I have to be very quiet inside myself afterward. But I got married to a very stubborn man named Aaron Hokanson, and he said, you're going to write. You're not going to speak anymore. I've been hearing you talk about this book. You're going to write. So for 2 months, I sat in our basement, and I wrote the first draft of the book. And by then, the words were just gushing out of me because my dad is a storyteller, because he says that his only gift to us are his tears and his words. He's gifted me with so much in all of the long years that we've spent together. You know, long before I rode a car or a bike, I saw the world from my father's shoulders. I was 6 years old, I was 8 years old, and I would hold on to whatever hair he had. And just that was my ride into the world, you know. My dad used to point to the sky when we were living in Bambinai refugee camp, and everybody was poor, and most people were hungry, and Hmong people were dying all the time, and he would say, look, the sunlight is dancing on your arms. He walked me beneath the leaves, and he said, the sunlight is dancing on your arms. That's how beautiful the world is. And so my father had, it's like a bag, right? You put so much in it. Pull the string, everything comes out.
This is ku ye ku lu nang ku yin ba shi ya ya zu tu nang jiao le ya ku yo long ku ga ku hou ne su na na ku lu nang.
I'm going to answer your question by telling you a little bit more about myself. When I was born, my father was ready, and by the time I knew, my father was gone. All I knew was what my brothers told me, and they said that we share the same father. My father didn't leave many words for me. All of my life, there's been a hunger for language, a hunger for words. When I had children, I taught them from my mistakes. Every mistake I made, I tried to teach them something worthwhile from it. That's how I raised them. In many ways, my dad has always said that he is nothing more and nothing less than the father he imagined for himself, at his best and at his worst. I belong to an imaginary man. For my father's lifetime, in his life, he's always learned how to change himself to survive the circumstances and the conditions around him. My grandma, who was a woman raising seven young boys into men in a time when the world was falling apart, she said that the most important thing to her was that they were alive. She didn't care how many times they bowed, that they were alive, that they could stand again was what mattered. My father has taught us differently. He's taught us that there's nothing scary about poverty. We've been poor all of our lives, you know, and then that if poverty is our only enemy, then we should go for our dreams. How else do you create a writer in a single generation? I think one of the great American presidents says that usually takes three. But I have an older sister who I think learned the hard lessons from our father. Dao said that life was like a ladder. If she's going to be the first tier, then I should be the second. So she stayed at Hamlin so I could go to Carleton. She went to Hamlin Law, became the lawyer that we needed her to be so that I could go to Columbia to become the writer that we dreamed of. It is my hope that my writing has the power to change the lives of the people in it. In each and every single day, I wake up and I understand that I am the happy ending that my mom and my dad have been waiting for. No matter how small I feel, no matter how much racism I face in the places I go, no matter what people do to me, when I was very young, there was a moment when I was very unsure of myself, and I felt like my mom and dad wanted me to get good grades. They wanted me to take good care of the children. They wanted so much, and I could not be so much. And I cried about it. And my mom has it on a tape recording that she plays for my siblings occasionally. But I taped myself crying about it. And my dad came in and he said to me, no matter how small you are, no matter how tiny you feel, you're the best thing, the biggest thing I have going forward. That's how I try to live my life. And so, yeah, I'm continually in conversations. I do what I can, where I can, because I only have one lifetime. My daddy never had a father to catch him if he fell. I have a man who would catch me anytime, every time. You know, I the first time I learned how to ride a bike, I went to the tallest hill in the McDonough Housing Project, and I came down that hill, and I didn't know how to stop. And halfway through, there was a wall, and I knew it was going to be painful. But before I hit that wall, my father came flying out of our house. He kicked the bike, and he caught me in his arms. Because of my father, Joe, that's why I do the work that I do so fearlessly and so courageously. He belongs to a woman who said that build a life because of faith, not fear. And that's the privilege. I can live my life the way I can live my life because of my daddy. I don't know how many times he's bowed his back, but I would not be here before you if I didn't. I wasn't sitting on that back. My dad is more afraid than I am, but he has more reasons to fear. Yes, in the back. I think that's such an important question. The reality is, I've always felt like there was a fire burning under me. I feel a great sense of urgency in the life that I live, and there are so many stories that I want to tell. So I'm always hopping from story to story, which then is also to say this: a work in translation becomes its own thing. For me, Hmong is a language of love. I can't kick in the same way that I can do in English. Like, fuck you, I can say it in my books, I can say it out loud. I can't say this in Hmong. You guys don't want to hear me say it in Hmong, that's the truth too. So my relationship to the language is different, but for me to translate it, it would be its own living piece of art. It would be its own thing. I know that. Because I've also seen my books translated into other languages, and it becomes so much the translator's understanding and their work of art. And so at this point in my life, I would love to have 5 years, five good years, because that's how long it takes to do a good book, to devote to translating these works into Hmong. But right now, I don't have time. My heart is still beating too fast. And maybe it's a product of my age. I'm 36 years old. You know, but I also, you know, when I gave birth to my little boy 17 months ago, I died. I clocked out. My mom called my dad and said, "Your daughter is dead." And so I've been coming back to life. And what I've realized is we have the time we need to do the work that we believe in. And I believe in my language, and I believe the work that I can do in my language. So yes, the short answer is yes. The long answer is it's going to take some time for me to learn the art of calming down my speeding heart so I'm not running from story to story. Because I want to do children's books too. There's so much. And then poetry. I'm a poet's daughter. Yep, right there. I'll let Dad answer this one. My dad said a long time ago, we're people from the hills and the mountains. There were no musical accompaniments. At the same time, I want to add, my mom and dad had recordings of the birds chirping and the insects from Laos and Thailand that they've been listening to for years. That is the instrumentation that they live by. And so while there is no instrumentation, there is, because it's usually an art done outside. Hmong men and women both can sing it. In fact, most of the masters that my daddy studies from on YouTube are women. So when Dad was singing, I didn't really understand all of it because it was all in Hmong. It wasn't until the translation that I really understood where the story was going and what was happening. In future, are you going to try to transliterate more of your dad's songs into prose? I want my dad to sing more songs. I would do what it takes for him to sing more songs. At the same time, I want to say my translations, my transliteration, with whatever license I take, it isn't as beautiful as my dad's language. The imagery isn't as crisp. The varieties of flowers here in the Twin Cities that I know are very different than the ones he references when he's talking about Thailand and Laos. You know, the flowers that they smelled, mom and dad smelled all those years ago in the jungles of Laos. I do creative nonfiction though, so I can use my imagination, right? I can flag you and say I'm imagining and create that landscape for you. But so long as my dad continues to sing, if he wants me to, if there's space for me to do it, I would translate it anywhere. Like he says, no matter how inadequate, I'm still his best card going forward. Right here, yes.
Such a gift to meet, you know, someone that you've written about. And I wondered if you would have the opportunity to meet your mother.
Yeah. Mama, go back up. She's very shy, but I'm asking her to stand up. That's my mom.
For everything that they've done in their life to bring their children, I don't know the other children, but to bring you forward.
When they chose to Yanel, don't they have me your good bonnet, little me your the shiku, when they chose they had no choice. I chose them. one final, yes? When I look at my age and I look at my limits, the limits of my language, it is hard to plan for a future in this country. My dad, though, so I get to go with him to doctor's appointments and stuff, and I get to interpret for him. And the one thing that he said not too long ago is he spends his days doing everything we need. And so if I have a talk, for example, I'm going to go to New York City on March 15th and 16th to see if the song poet can win the National Book Critics Circle Award. It's a finalist, right? And it's super exciting because it's the first time that Hmong, that we get to go there to do that. And I want to speak Hmong there, but I can't just up and leave. You know, it's a hard task. But I can because my mom and my dad, the moment I said it, they said, we'll take care of your kids. We'll be there all the way. I have never asked anything of my parents that they've not given me. And so right now, my mom and my dad, he says he has no plans, but he's also become an elder in our family. So he gets phone calls all the time. I had to tell him to turn off his phone when we came here because young people like to get in trouble. And when they're in trouble, then they go searching for the people who they know love them. And so my dad's phone is buzzing all the time. My mom hates it. Because especially when they're in the car. So my dad has become an elder in our family and our community. And I think he's stepping up very admirably. For myself, I'm working on book number 3. It is a hard book because it's a book about rape. In many ways, it's a creative response to Brock Turner, what happened at Stanford. It is a book, when I first imagined it, it was going to be inspired by my grandma about a young girl who becomes a healer because everybody in her life is gone, has died. But then in the last 2 to 3 years, I think I've discovered, if you go to the Minneapolis Institute of Art right now, there's an essay that I've written right by Rembrandt's The Rape of Lucretia. There's an essay that I've written right beside that painting about rape, because how many times when raped do we have to die to come back to life if we make it at all? And so it's a hard, heavy book. I've given myself until the end of March to do the first draft. Because I have babies now and I can't have writer's block in the same way I did before. So that's what I'm out to do. But I love this writing life. I teach and I teach actively because it's like harvesting from a garden of good ideas. You know, whether my students know what they're doing, whether it's working or not, whether they choose to follow the advice I give them on the page or not, I'm getting bathed in their ideas. And so I teach. But teaching can be consuming, and it can take all of your time. And for me, it takes all of my heart. And so I can only write when I'm not teaching. And I have a little bit over a month before I go back to Carleton College to teach my spring term. So that's what's next for me. Thank you, all of you, for being here. I will be in the back signing books with that.